Hey friends, it's Friday, August the 28th, and we are here with our daily devotion from Mark chapter 2. Today we'll be looking at Mark 2, 18 through 22. Let me read that for us. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said to him being Jesus, why do John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast in that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wines will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins. Now, I'm going to start by telling you a little story about my wedding day, which was a little over 13 and a half years ago, and cold, gray, and slightly slushy northeastern Ohio. Now, the night before the wedding, I spent in a hotel room with some of my groomsmen, and we woke up a little bit late on the morning of the wedding day, but we knew that we didn't really have to be anywhere anytime soon, so we kind of went down to the pool in the bottom of the hotel, hung around there for a while. There wasn't a clock, so we didn't really know what time it was. As we started seeing some of the guests from also out-of-town guests that were going to the wedding start mingling in the lobby of the hotel, that's when we kind of realized it was time to get ourselves together and head over towards the church. Now, I had forgotten up until that point that I needed to stop by the next hotel to drop off my honeymoon bag. And so the groomsmen all hopped in the car and they went off to get a bite to eat, and we're going to meet at the church. I got in with another friend and we drove off to the other hotel, which was unbeknownst to me, about 15 miles in the opposite direction. So over an hour later, I finally got there to the church, arrived in the room where everyone was getting ready. All the seven groomsmen were 100% dressed, ready to go out, and here I walk in with my shorts and t-shirt, and kind of quickly got ready, and we all walked out with moments to spare as the beautiful bride was preparing to walk down the aisle. Now, one of the things that I remember from that day is how beautiful my wife was, my bride, soon-to-be wife, was, but also how hungry I was, because I had missed like every meal that day. You know, we woke up too late for breakfast, I skipped out on lunch, and so, this beautiful woman's walking towards me, my knees are shaking, partially because of nerves, but also partially because I just hadn't eaten anything all day long, and that's kind of one of those great things that I'll always remember. So now we go back to this story, and we have this, this thing comes after Mark lists it right after the episode where Jesus and his disciples are at Levi's house at his big party. Now, we don't know if that's exactly when it happened. It could have been that evening. It could have been later on sometime. But that's where Mark sets the scene for this question. And the disciples of the Pharisees and also of John the Baptist wanted to know why Jesus and his disciples weren't fasting. Now, fasting was something that the Old Testament actually did command one day a year, which was on the Day of Atonement. And there are other examples throughout the scriptures of other times people would be fasting, usually at a time of lament or mourning, some sort of occasion like that. You know, it was a voluntary thing. So, of course, the Pharisees had taken something that was voluntary and turned it into something compulsory. The ideal religious person to the Pharisees was somebody that had fasted two times every week. Typically, that would be Mondays and Thursdays. And they did so out of an obligation. This religious obligation is sort of an act of righteousness or an act of holiness. And they wanted to know why Jesus, who was this powerful teacher and miracle worker, didn't follow the same customs and rules that they did. Now, Jesus, of course, was not opposed to fasting. We saw at the beginning of the book of Mark that he's out for 40 days fasting in the wilderness, preparing for ministry. But fasting for Jesus, he kind of understood that this was something to be done in lament or in preparation for work to be done. And not only that, but during a celebration, it was inappropriate to fast. You know, for a first century, during a first century Jewish wedding, which was a big party, this huge feast, and the groom would gather all of the bridal party after he had prepared the home that he and the bride were going to live in. The bridal party with the groom would gather up. They would parade across town, grab the bride, take her back to the home. There they would have a ceremony and then an entire week's worth of feasting. And the bride and the groom were treated like the king and queen. Sometimes they would even have crowns that they would wear all through the week. You know, instead of going on a honeymoon, they would stay there, invite the whole town. Everyone that they knew would come and join in their feast. And even if you had made some sort of personal vow to fast, you were excused from that vow during the time of the feast because it would have been inappropriate to look, to be fasting while everyone else was feasting. Jesus tells here the scribes and even the disciples of John the Baptist that while he was present, it was not appropriate for his disciples to fast because he was the bridegroom. He was the bridegroom. He came and brought life to the party, and not just some sort of addition, something else, some other rule or some other command that they had to follow, but Jesus came to bring entirely new life. One of the things I think that we sometimes fall into the trap of is when we come to faith in Jesus, or we look at other people and we see unbelievers, we think, you know, if only they just, you know, their lives look so good, they're so well put together, if only they just had Jesus, he would be kind of like the final piece, you know, the missing piece of the puzzle in order to have a good life. But that's not at all what Jesus is saying. He kind of completes the analogy by using this example of wineskins and of a patch of clothing. So you don't take, when you're patching a garment, you don't take old clothes and put on a brand new patch. Well, why? Because after you sew it on and that new cloth gets exposed to the elements, it's out, it gets wet and it shrinks, it's gonna tear even worse that old clothing. Same way, if you have an empty old wineskin, you don't take it and fill it with new wine because that new wine is still alive, it's still fermenting, and it's going to expand, but that old wineskin is rigid and hard, and it won't be able to handle that new life which is put inside of it. And Jesus says that the life of his followers, the life of his disciples, is going to have to change completely, because what he brings is something that's alive. You know, he comes into these people, us, who are dead in our sins, and of course, dead people can't do anything, and he brings life. He brings real life. He doesn't just add on to what we've already done. He doesn't take it and say, hey, you know what, you've done pretty good. All you're missing is just do a couple more of these things and you'll have your perfect righteousness and holiness. That's a very kind of Pharisaical thing to say, right? That Jesus, only your disciples now need to add this fasting. You need to add this other thing. But he's saying that in me is new life and true life. And if you try to take this life, this new life within me and with my spirit, and put it into something old, it can't handle it. You know, it's going to explode completely. You're going to ruin everything. The wineskin's going to be destroyed, and the wine, the cloth and the clothing, the patch and the old cloth, it's all going to be destroyed. So what Jesus is saying is that I come to bring new life. not something in addition to. In fact, I came to fulfill the law and all of the commandments in order that they might have new life through a new commandment in my blood. You know, Jesus came to live and to die so that you and I could find our true life in him, so that we could know forgiveness for our sins. And the Bible talks about all our righteousness, all our acts of holiness are nothing but filthy rags compared to the righteousness of Jesus. But Jesus offers us his perfect righteousness when we put our faith and our trust in him, not in our own works, not in anything that we've done. You know, because if you and I were left to ourselves, you'd be like me, that poor sap who almost missed his wedding day because he was lost on the highway, right? Because he wasn't paying attention at the right time, because he was too hungry. You know, if I'd have stopped off somewhere and got a bite to eat, I could have missed everything. Jesus says, don't miss this. Come and enjoy. Have new life. I'm going to not just add on to what you're doing, but I'm going to make it completely 100% better. There's nothing like it, so come enjoy it with me. So won't you pray with me? Thanks so much for joining us today. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you come to bring life. God, you realize our situations. You know what it is that we do. God, you know that in our pride, oftentimes we think that we're pretty good even without you. And we need you just to kind of get us over the lip, to push us over the edge in our way of working towards God. But that's not at all what we see. Lord, on our own, we are dead in our sins. There's nothing that we can do. There's nothing that we bring to your table except for our filth and our wretchedness. But Jesus, you came that we can enjoy this new life. You kept the law perfectly in your body. And through your blood, you began a new covenant with us, a covenant of grace. And Lord, help us to believe that. Help us to honor you, to love you, and to trust you. To experience that new life and to live it with joy each day, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks so much for joining us, guys. We'll see everyone back again next week, Monday. Join us this Sunday, either online or right here in the sanctuary at 10:30 if you don't have another church home. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.